Good morning. Is everybody here? Just trying to figure out this live feed, so give me just a moment, please. This is new technology, at least for me. Many of you already know how to do this. You're well aware of how to use these new technologies, but I don't. So we're trying to figure this out. You know, there's a lot of uncertainty right now in our nation, and I want to talk about that here in just a minute. I want to give you a few minutes for a few people to get on and join us, but they can watch this. It's a really strange thing to come to the church building, and I'm the only one here. However, the church isn't just a building. And so I want to talk real quickly, just a few things about some housekeeping things that we're going to be doing here moving forward, and maybe kind of address this pandemic for right now. And then I want to read some scripture, and we're going to talk about God's word, and we're going to pray together. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. Just want to say this. I mean, without question, these are certainly uncertain times that we live in right now, and there's many concerns that we all share, that we all have, physical concerns, spiritual concerns. Our daily routines have been greatly disrupted. As many of you have already seen, read, or are aware of, the Governor of Missouri and the DHSS have issued a social distancing order that is in effect until 12:01 a.m. Monday, April 6th. So in light of that mandate and out of a deep concern and love for our church family, our families, our community, we've suspended all meetings and activities in the church building until that order has expired. However, I want to say again, the church is not the building. Just because we're not meeting in the building doesn't mean we're no longer the church. Really, truly, this, I believe, gives us an amazing opportunity to demonstrate the love of Christ, to bind together, to join together, and really serve one another in the needs that we have. Excuse me. So I have just a few suggestions, just a couple things maybe for us to consider in these times. Let's be praying for one another, okay? Call and check in on each other. Write letters, write postcards, send messages. Let's stay in touch. We need to learn of each other's needs and provide for them. You know, a lot of us have maybe a little extra downtime at the moment. Not what we desired, but here it is. So this might be an opportunity for us to maybe scale back on our busyness and focus on some things that are really important in relationships. I would encourage you to spend time each day in prayer. I'd encourage you to spend time each day in the Word of God. And here's the thing, we really need to be open with each other in these days. We need to be able to express our needs and our concerns to each other. If you have a need, please share it. You know, in the church, probably one of the things that we deal with that might be one of the bigger struggles is sharing our needs. We want to serve and help others, but it's difficult for us sometimes to open up and be vulnerable and let others know what our own needs are. So I would encourage you to do that in these times. This is an opportunity for us to learn and grow in our relationship with one another and our relationship with the Lord. My prayer in all of this is that the Lord God would use this for His glory, that those that have a relationship with Him would be strengthened and deepened in their faith through this, and those that do not would have an opportunity to be transformed and giving their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. So here's a couple of other things. If you have extra provisions, share them. You know, share your provisions, share your needs, share your testimony, share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And importantly here, and this is difficult for us, but we live in a world of technology, so maybe this is a little step easier for us. Stay connected. Okay, I just encourage you to stay connected. It's so easy to be isolated and feel like we're alone, but we really are not. And I'm looking forward to the time when we will join together in the building, be a family, have a meal together. It's going to be great. I'm so excited for that reunion. So let me read out of Psalm chapter 30. I'd like to read that to you. And then we're going to spend some time in prayer, and then we're going to talk about Deuteronomy, Joshua, some of the things that we've had in our reading for this week. So let me just read this to you. Excuse me, Psalm 31. O Lord, I've come to you for protection. Don't let me be disgraced. Save me, for you do what is right. Turn your ear to listen to me. Rescue me quickly. Be my rock of protection, a fortress where I will be safe. You are my rock and my fortress. For the honor of your name, lead me out of this danger. Pull me from the trap my enemies set for me, for I find protection in you alone. I trust my spirit into your hand. Rescue me, Lord, for you are a faithful God. I will be glad and rejoice in your unfailing love, for you have seen my troubles and you care about the anguish of my soul. You've not handed me over to my enemies, but have set me in a safe place. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I'm in distress. Tears blur my eyes. My body and soul are withering away. But I'm trusting you, O Lord, saying, you are my God. My future is in your hands. Rescue me from those who hunt me down. Let your favor shine on your servant. In your unfailing love, rescue me. How great is the goodness you have stored up for those who fear you. You lavish it on those who come to you for protection, blessing them before the watching world. You hide them in the shelter of your presence, safe from those who conspire against them. You shelter them in your presence, far from accusing tongues. Praise the Lord, for he has shown me the wonders of his unfailing love. He kept me safe when my city was under attack. In panic, I cried out, I am cut off from the Lord. But you heard my cry for mercy and answered my call for help. Love the Lord, all you godly ones. The Lord protects those who are loyal to him, but he harshly punishes the arrogant. So be strong and courageous, all you who put your hope in the Lord. Let's pray again. Father God, you are an amazing God. And I thank you for even small things like technology that can allow us to be together, even if we're not in the same room. And God, we just ask that your Holy Spirit would touch each one in our homes as we're gathered together. Father, you are the Spirit that connects each one. And Father, we just pray for your peace. We pray for your comfort. We pray for your counsel. These are troubling times, and we have anxiety and stress and worry and fear. But God, you are in control. And I pray that we would not trust our circumstances, our surroundings. I pray that we would trust only in you. Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you for the foundation that it can build beneath us, Father, that we can stand upon it and know that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And God, though we are in times that we have never seen before, you are not surprised. You still have a plan, and you still love us. You are still a God of mercy and unfailing grace. You are still faithful. We are so grateful for that, God. We thank you. Father, we just pray that as we go forward in these days, that you would give us protection. Father, that you would physically shield us from sickness and disease. Father, there are many that are dealing with grief in our community. There are many that are dealing with grief and fear worldwide, God. And we just pray for your comfort for them. We pray that this would be a time when all eyes would look to you. Father God, you are beyond compare. You are still full of mercy and forgiveness and love. And we are so thankful for that. We thank you for the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross that paid a debt that we never could, that we might have right standing in your eyes. What a gift. Father, we just pray that as we move forward together in the days to come, that you give us clarity, that you would give us open eyes to see the wisdom of the decisions that need to be made. Father, we pray for our governing authorities. We pray for those that are making very difficult decisions right now, God. We just pray for your wisdom, God, that you would direct us, not just as a family or a church or a community or a state, but as a nation and as a world, God. That Father, the right decisions would be made, that we would trust and rely upon you, and that you would lead us into a time when we would be close to you. Father, I pray that you would open our eyes to the opportunities that are before us in these days, in these times, God, that we would rise up to serve one another like we never have before. God, help us. Help us to hear your word. God, help us to shut out the noise of the enemy and the things that he would like for us to believe. God, I pray that his voice would be silenced, that he would be reminded that he has no victory, no dominion in our lives, God, that your voice is the only voice that we would hear. Father, help us to be obedient to the urgings of your Holy Spirit. Keep us connected. Father, keep us protected. And God, we just ask for your direction for each step that we take. We still love you. God, even in times that are uncertain and when we have circumstances that don't turn out the way we desire them to, Father, you are still good. Our situation does not change the truth of your goodness. We just honor you in that. I pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would direct this time together, and God, that it would be pleasing to you. We thank you so much. Even in times of trouble, we are thankful. We honor you and praise you today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, you'll have to bear with me a little bit as I try to read my notes and look at a camera. And those of you that are familiar with the way I normally speak, I'm usually walking around and taking my glasses on and off and being generally distracting. This is difficult to me. I've got a seatbelt on to keep me in my chair. Just want to try to express a few things to you. As many of you know, we've been reading through the Bible together chronologically. We are in Deuteronomy. If we finished up Deuteronomy this week and got into Joshua just a little bit. So even at this point, we've had the opportunity to read together Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, the book of Job. And we're just starting Joshua. And I had some decisions to make this week as there were so many things that are going on in the world. And I was trying to decide whether to speak to those things directly out of Scripture. And as I was reading the passages that we already had prescribed for the week, it just amazes me how well those fit our situation, our time, or our circumstances right now. So as we're in Deuteronomy, we read chapters 13 through 34 this last week. We read Psalm 90. We read the first 3 to 6 chapters of Joshua, depending on whether you landed on today's reading or stopped with yesterday. But I'd like to read just a few things. There's some ideas that really jumped out at me off of the page. But I want to say this before we even get into this. The backstory here, as we're finishing up Deuteronomy, many of us know the story of Moses and the delivery of the Israelites from the hands of the Egyptians, the people that they would not enter the land that God had given them. And so they wandered in the wilderness for a generation. For 40 years, they wandered. And now towards the end of Deuteronomy, this is summing it all up. Moses is talking to the people. They're recounting all the things that have happened. They're once again on the banks of the Jordan, ready to enter the promised land. But it's Moses' time to, it's going to be a challenge. I think I'm back. We're having a little bit of internet connectivity issues. However, I think we're back. So, as I was saying, this is a recount. Moses is relaying to the people again what they've experienced, just kind of in memory, to refresh their memory as they're getting ready to cross once again. But it is Moses' time to die. It is his time to go be with the Lord. And Joshua is going to take over as leadership for the Israelites. And so let me just read some of the things that come up before this process takes place. In Deuteronomy, chapter 15, I just want to read a couple verses here because I think these are so applicable to where we're at right now. This is what God says to them as Moses is recounting the law to them. Deuteronomy 15, 10 and 11 says this, "Give generously to the poor, not grudgingly, for the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. There will always be some in the land who are poor. That is why I'm commanding you to share freely with the poor and with others in need. Give generously to the poor. There will always be some in need. And God commands us to share freely with the poor and other believers in need. You know, I talked earlier about sharing our provisions, sharing our needs, sharing our faith, sharing our testimony, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's so important that we are a sharing community through this. So a lot of these things that, even as they're dealing with a time that's way in the past, right, a historical account, those things are still applicable to us today. And this is what he says in Deuteronomy 23 and 4. He says, "Listen to me. Do not be afraid as you go out to fight your enemies today. Do not lose heart or panic or tremble before them, for the Lord your God is going with you. He will fight for you against your enemies, and he will give you victory." Did you catch that? Don't lose heart. Don't panic. God is going with you. He will fight for you. And then as Moses recounts the blessings of God in Deuteronomy 28, many of us are aware of this passage. This is a familiar passage to us. It says, "Your towns and your fields will be blessed, your children and your crops will be blessed, the offspring of your herds and flocks will be blessed, fruit baskets and breadboards will be blessed, wherever you go, whatever you do, you will be blessed." And it recounts a lot of blessings that are available through the hand of God. Here's the thing, these blessings were not strictly about the gain and prosperity of God's people. Excuse me, they were more about God demonstrating his love and mercy through his people. You know, God's word is not primarily about the people he worked through. It's about how he reveals himself to us through his work. In Deuteronomy 30:15, and I know I'm skipping around a lot here, I will get to a point eventually. Right? Deuteronomy 30, 15 and 16. He says this, "Today I'm giving you a choice between life and death, between prosperity and disaster. For I command you this day to love the Lord your God, to keep his commands, decrees, and regulations by walking in his ways. If you do this, you will live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you and the land you're about to enter and occupy." We have the choice between life and death. And then he describes what life is. Life is loving the Lord. Life is keeping his word. Life is committing ourselves fully to him and walking in his ways. No, Jesus came that we might have life and have life abundantly. He said in John 10:10 that the thief comes only to kill, steal, and destroy. But I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. He came so we could even have the ability to love the Lord. So we would have the ability to walk and commit ourselves to him and walk in his ways. So if we have the choice between life and death, what is death? Death is this. It's loving the world and the desires of our flesh. It's continuing to live in our sin. Romans 6:23 said, "The wages of sin is death." So we have the choice between life and death. My prayer is that many of you have already chosen life, but there are many that need to still make that choice. They still have that choice available, and that's why it's so important that we share the love of Christ even more strongly now than maybe ever before in our lifetimes in this generation. So as we move on into Deuteronomy 31, we find that it is Moses' time to die. And yet, let me read a couple of verses to you, because I'm thinking about how Moses might have taken this whole situation. You know, he's been a leader of this nation for over 40 years, and he's not allowed to enter the land because he failed in one place to display the holiness of God as he was instructed. And God takes him up on a mountain, and he says, "I'm going to show you the land. I'm going to show it from border to border. I'm going to let you see the land, but you're not going to be able to go in it." He said, "Moses, it's your time to die. It's your time to be finished leading the people. Joshua will take over." But as he's climbing this mountain, it just occurs to me that he knows this is going to be his last trip up the mountain. And I wonder about if the anxiety or if he had uncertainty. And if he did, how encouraging would this be when God said this to him? This is in Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and don't panic, for the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail nor abandon you. And he repeats it in Deuteronomy 31:8. He says, do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord will personally go ahead of you. He will be with you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. Be strong. Be courageous. Do not fear. God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail nor abandon you. What amazing news. What a great word that God gave to him to encourage him as he was making this final climb. As we read on in Deuteronomy 32, Moses has an attitude of praise, of thanksgiving to God, and he expresses that in Deuteronomy 32. And then in Psalm 90, he wrote, actually, there's about four chapters of a prayer. I'm not going to read all four chapters, but I do want to read portions of Psalm 90 to you, because this is Moses' attitude as he's getting ready to leave everything that he has known in this lifetime. He says this in Deuteronomy 32, 3 and 4, I will proclaim the name of the Lord. How glorious is our God! He is the rock, his deeds are perfect. Everything he does is just and fair. He is a faithful God who does no wrong. How just and upright he is. And then in Psalm 90, in the prayer of Moses, he says this, Lord, through all the generations, you have been our home. Before the mountains were born, before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from beginning to end, you are God. He says, teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom. He is glorious. He is the rock. His deeds are perfect. He is just and fair. He is faithful. He does no wrong. He is just and upright. Moses is saying, God, you alone are God. What a reminder and an amazing attitude that he had. So as Moses' time has finished on the earth, Joshua is called up to lead in Moses' place. And just as when Moses' time to die came and God spoke strength and courage into him, as Joshua is raising up into leadership, God speaks strength and courage into him as well. And in Joshua chapter 1, 7 through 9, I think many of you will recognize, particularly Joshua 1, 9. I've seen this a lot lately, floating around the internet, and it's just amazing that this was our prescribed reading to begin with for this week. So Joshua 1, 7 through 9 reads this way, be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. And here's verse 9. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord God is with you wherever you go. God speaks strength and courage into Moses. He speaks strength and courage into Joshua. And through his word, he's speaking strength and courage into us. He says, be strong, be courageous, obey his word, study his word, meditate on it day and night. And he says it again, be strong, be courageous, do not fear, do not be discouraged. God is with you wherever you go. And so as Moses takes over the leadership, they get ready to enter the promised land. And this part of the story just amazes me. I'm just going to give you a summary of it. I'll read a couple of verses here in just a minute. But the summary is this. God instructs Joshua to gather up his men to go across the Jordan to enter the promised land. And he doesn't give him any instructions, really. He says, be ready to go in 3 days. Joshua, you've got 3 days to get ready. So Joshua brings his commanders in and he says, look, I want you to gear up and get ready. In 3 days, we're crossing the river. Now, there might have been questions, but there are none recorded in Scripture. This was not a place where they stopped to build a bridge. They didn't go look for another place to cross. Just in obedience, they prepared. They gathered their things, and in 3 days, they were ready. And so God said, I want the priests to go first, and I want them to carry the Ark of the Covenant. And I'm thinking, if I was in their position, wouldn't you be looking for some way to cross? Right? We're just supposed to walk across. But God said this, as soon as your feet touch the water, I will stop up the water as a wall, and you'll go through on dry ground. So let me read this in Joshua 3. This is verse 13. The priests will carry the ark of the Lord of all the earth. As soon as their feet touch the water, the flow of water will be cut off upstream, and the river will stand up like a wall. Get that? The priests had to step into the water before they parted. They had to step out in faith. They didn't wait for the water to part before they were moving forward. And I think that in so many ways, how that applies to our life. Right? There's so many times that we want all the answers. We want all the lights to turn green before we leave the driveway. But are we ready to step in? Are we ready to get our feet wet even before we see God moving? Just out of absolute trust and faith. And they moved forward and got their feet wet. Right? That could have been a very dangerous thing, but God told them He would go before them. He said, be strong, be courageous, don't fear. He said, I'm going to go before you personally. And then they took some memorial stones. Once they reached the other side on dry ground, they took some stones and set them up as memorial. You know, the only reason they did that was so they would not forget the goodness of God. And sometimes when we're in a situation in our life, and right now when things seem scary and uncertain in our world, it's easy to forget what God's done for us. It's easy to forget the promises that He has given us. So I don't know what your memorial stones would look like in your life, but I encourage you. Don't forget what He's done. Don't forget who He is. You know, God did these things so that all the nations of the earth would know who He is. So I'm just going to recap what we've looked at in the scriptures, and we're going to be done for today. But He says this, share generously, be strong and courageous, keep moving forward. Even if the waters haven't parted before you, keep moving forward. At its heart, this passage isn't about the people that God chose to work through. It's not even about how they responded to the situation as much as it's about how God responds to our situation. You know, is how we respond important? Yes, it is. But really only to the part that it reflects God's glory. Reflects His power in our lives. Here's what I see in these passages. This is about what we can learn about God's character, about His conduct, about how He responds to our situation. You know, God responded by reminding His people who He is, that no matter how hard their circumstances may be, He is still in control. He still has a plan for us. He's still filled with grace and mercy and compassion and love and kindness and patience. He still loves us. So here's what I would encourage you from this. Remember who God is, what He's done, and what He'll do. He is glorious, just, fair, perfect, and faithful. He is the rock. He's paid a debt that we never could, that we might have life. That we'd have the choice between life and death, that we could choose life, that we could love God, that we commit to Him, that we could walk in the Word, that we could walk in His ways. And He will go before us. He will never fail or abandon us. He will speak strength and courage into us. Thank you, Lord. You are good. Let's pray together. Father God, we just thank you that you are good, that you are just, that you are perfect, that you are fair, that you are our rock. We thank you for the strength and the courage that you speak into us. We thank you for the truth of your word. God, I pray that as we continue to look through your word together, that you would continue to reveal yourself to us, that we would learn more about your character, about your conduct. We would learn better how to obey your commands, how to walk in your ways. God, we thank you that you are a good God. Again, we pray for your protection over us physically. But God, we pray that you would guide us spiritually, that we'd be strengthened and brought courage through the coming days. We honor you today. We love you, Father. We thank you for loving us. We bind together as your children and pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you for joining me today. This has been quite an experience. I'm prayerful, hopeful that things will look different in the future very soon. That we'll be back together again. In the meantime, stay connected. Members of our church family will be sending out some letters this week, so you'll each receive ways to stay connected with one another and as a church. I love each one of you and pray that God would speak strength and courage into you today. I love you.